Hi dear friends and subscribers, welcome to the Cricket Happening Show with your host Ram today. And in this part of the Cricket Happening Show, we are going to look at South Africa having a victory. It was not so easy, but well, they did it. And in fact, Pakistan were rolled out for 169 in the second innings today. And South Africa showed what they are capable of and why they are the number one team in Test cricket. By actually, I would say they have already wrapped up the series because there are only three test matches and South Africa have taken a 2-0 lead, a winning lead, 2-0 winning lead in the series with only one test to go. And what a performance from South Africa, especially one has to talk about Robin Peterson's valuable innings the other day when South Africa were really struggling. And if Pakistan had actually bowled them out for probably lesser runs, and not, probably they would have not even reached 326, then probably we would have had a different tale to tell with Saeed Ajmal bowling so well and taking 10 wickets in the particular match. But Robin Peterson, very rightly so, was named man of the match for his splendid innings of 84 with 15 fours. He was named the man of the match. So today the proceedings all started, and as far as this Cricket Happening Show is concerned, I'll be talking about this particular match where South Africa have already taken the series against Pakistan 2-0 with one more test match to go. And I'm told this was their fifth consecutive test win and the sixth test series win in a row. That's a stupendous performance from South Africa. So in Newlands, Cape Town today, South Africa defeating Pakistan by four wickets at the Newlands Cape Town ground. Now, just talking about how the game really went on today, it all started with Pakistan resuming the overnight score of 100 for 3. And initially it was good. Misbah-ul-Haq and Azhar Ali were trying to, do the hard work, and that was pretty necessary because in Newlands Cape Town, what one has seen is the first out of play is pretty essential, where it definitely helps the pace bowlers, the seam and swing. But today, I thought Azhar Ali and Misbah-ul-Haq really buckled themselves to the task and really saw to it that they first blunted the Pakistan, the South African pace attack of Dale Steyn, Vernon Philander. Yes, they were definitely crippled by Morne Mortel not taking any part in the game, but it was very essential, and that's what they precisely did. But once they have done all the hard work and they had actually taken this score on to 114, that was the time things started going downhill for Pakistan, because 45 for 3, as Pakistan always have the air of unpredictability as far as their way of batting is concerned. That's what precisely happened. From a score of 114 for 3 at one particular stage, the Pakistan team totally collapsed for 169 all out, and that was the key. So what happened really was the first wicket to go was Misbah-ul-Haq, who was actually, this wicket was from Robin Peterson. Misbah-ul-Haq trying to sweep a delivery from Peterson, getting the top edge, Smith making no mistake, and Misbah-ul-Haq was walking for 44 with 4 fours and 3 sixes. And after that, Asif Shafiq came in, entertained, he looked good, he was stroking the ball pretty sweetly, but that was it. Vernon Philander, as you know, he really loves the Newlands Cape Town ground. And once again, Vernon Philander didn't take a fiver, but he had figures of 19 overs, 6 maidens, 40 runs and 4 wickets. What he did is, first he got rid of Asif Shafiq. Asif Shafiq was clean bowled by Philander for 19, the 3 boundaries. The next wicket to go, Sarfraz Ahmed, which was a very silly dismissal on the part of Sarfraz Ahmed. He was clean bowled by Robin Peterson for 5 with just one boundary. Azhar Ali, as he was sticking it out, he was trying to be there, holding the innings. But well, he was not getting any support from the other end as far as the tailenders were concerned. And finally, Azhar Ali succumbed as Vernon Philander got a beautiful ball to nip out, and De Villiers took the catch, and he was gone for 65 with 7 fours. And it was, once Azhar Ali went, it was all over for Pakistan, with Umar Gul consumed by Philander, consumed by Peterson of the bowling of Philander for a duck. Saeed Ajmal, clean bowled by Peterson for 4. And Mohammad Irfan, the tall man, caught Peterson bowled steam for 2. It was all over for Pakistan, 169 all out. The bowling figures made a tremendous rating. 18.3 overs, 5 maidens, 38 runs and 3 wickets for Dale Steyn, the pacer. Vernon Philander, the magician, 19 overs, 6 maidens, 40 runs and 4 wickets. Plenty of bowling performances, taking 9 wickets in a match. And Newlands Cape Town is something that he would have it in his cupboard for quite a long time. Morning, Morgul, 3.1 overs, no made and none for 8, not taking any further part in the game. Robin Peterson also bowled well. In fact, that was the precise reason he got the man of the match. 29 overs, 8 maidens, 73 runs and 3 wickets. And carries 5.5 overs, 2 maidens, none for 8. Now, that was something. 169 score was pretty good for South Africa, because what happened is they basically probably overnight they might have been worried that if Pakistan go on to make a 250 or a 300, I mean, if they make 250 or 270 odd, then you know, on this pitch it would have been pretty difficult. You know, the reason being that Syed Ajmal would have been the one who had been the most threatening. But for South Africa, they really worked hard and bowled out the Pakistanis for 169. They wanted to make sure that they don't have a big score to actually chase, and that's what they precisely did. So the 182 was the total for them in front. It all started with the breakthrough being given by Umar Gul. Alvaro Peterson, trying to flick a delivery, got it on his pads, and he was adjudged LBW bowled Umar Gul for one. The next to go was Graham Smith, once again falling a victim to Syed Ajmal. Actually, what Graham Smith did, he played across the line. Again, this is the second time in this test that Graham Smith has tried to play across the line to Syed Ajmal, paid the penalty. He was adjudged LBW, bowled Syed Ajmal for 29, the two boundaries. So that was 63 for 2, and Jack Scalise was joined in by Amla. Amla was looking good, he was looking solid as a rock. And he was also playing those majestic offside shots that he normally is bound to play. Jack Scalise was there at the other end. And Jack Scalise played some wonderful, I would say, he played some scorching cover drives. And each of the cover drives that he played was a real gem. But Jack Scalise was gone. Syed Ajmal, as I said, the ball, this particular track, the ball was turning, the ball was kicking up, the batsman had to be watchful, and that's what precisely Ashim Amla and Jack Scalise did. But Jack Scalise was gone. As Jack Scalise, what he did is he tried to flick a delivery from Ajmal. He was coming onto the stumps, and he had exposed his middle and leg stump, and he was wrapped in the pads, and one could see the stumps there. So it was a pretty easy easy call for the umpire, and the umpire raised the finger. Jack Scalise was gone. LBW bowled Syed Ajmal for 21 with 3 boundaries, making the score 88 for 3. But nothing to really worry about, as Amla was joined in by A.B. de Villiers, and A.B. de Villiers was looking absolutely confident with his stroke making. Ashim Amla was carrying on in the same vein, and just a sort of not a scare, I would say, sort of, because Syed Ajmal was always there. He was bowling superbly, so that might have been South Africa might be, I mean, they were pretty watchful against Syed Ajmal. But A.B. de Villiers actually used his feet and dispatched Ajmal for a boundary. That was good to see. But the next wicket to go was Ashim Amla. They were almost close to the target, probably 32 runs. And Ashim Amla was the next to go, as he was clean bowled by Syed Ajmal for 58 with 7-4. But they had absolutely no worries. But in the quest of actually finishing off the match early for South Africa, in fact, they lost some wickets. A.B. de Villiers was snapped up by Sarfraz Ahmed, the wicketkeeper behind the stumps, of the bowling of Tanveer Ahmed for 36 with 4 fours. And Fatou Prezzé also departed. LBW bowled Syed Ajmal for 15 with 2 fours. But there was no further mishap, and there was no further alarms for South Africa, as they went through the target with lots of ease. 182 for 6, South Africa winning the match. Dean Elgar remained unbeaten on 11 of 13 balls with 1-4. Robin Peterson, the man of the match, was not out on 1. It was all over for Pakistan. South Africa took a 2-0 series win. In fact, they already won the series, as said, a winning lead in the series. Bowling figures, Irfan, 10 overs, 1 minute, none for 35, bowls with lots of pace. Umar Gul, 8 overs, 46 runs, 1 wicket, was not looking good today. Syed Ajmal, absolutely the threat there, 18.1 overs, 2 minutes, 51 runs and 4 wickets. Hafiz, 2 overs, 1 minute, no one, and as I said, I mean, one thing that I would really like to make a point here, one was really wondering as to why Mohammad Hafiz bowled only 2 overs for 11 runs, and he was not given lots of bowling, because you know the ball was turning. There was balls were keeping low, there were balls which are kicking up. I would have been preferred Syed Ajmal and Mohammad Hafiz to operate in tandem and put some pressure on South Africa. So unfortunately, Misbah Ul-Haq is a very good captain, but I was really surprised that Mohammad Hafiz was not really pressed into service and not given lots of overs. The professor was not given lots of overs today. Ranveer Ahmed, 5 overs, no made in 1 for 34. South Africa leading the 3-match series with Robin Peterson, rightly so for his absolutely valuable knock of 84 runs, being named man of the match. Now, we've shifted the focus here very pretty quickly because my YouTube broadcast is coming to an end. New Zealand versus England, it was the first one day international. It's going to be pretty brief here. New Zealand actually took a 1-0 lead in the series. In fact, under McCullum's captaincy, what they are showing is they are growing in confidence as far as international cricket is concerned now. They are definitely doing a lot of good for their ICC rankings now, as New Zealand actually picked up a win under the belt and actually opened up the one day international series with a bang by winning this match by 3 wickets against England. England were the ones who batted first, making 258. They were all out for 258 today. The contributions coming in from the top there, Ian Bell making 64 of 79 balls with 6 fours and 2 sixes, looked solid. Jonathan Trott coming back played pretty well, 68 of 90 balls with 6 fours. Joe Root continued in his merry way, and as you know, he did well against India, and he seems to be a real future player for Joe Root, included in all the 3 formats of the game for England. He contributed a very nice 56 of 64 balls with 4 fours. Josh Butler went on with his pyrotechnics, 21 of 13 deliveries with 2 sixes. 17 coming off Chris Woakes' bat, was included in the squad, 22 of just 16 deliveries with 3 fours. 258 was the score for England after losing the toss. In fact, New Zealand won the toss and inserted England in. Bowling figures, Mitchell McLennan, who would unfortunately not be taking any further part in this one day international season, which is pretty sad. 9.4 overs no made in 56 runs at 4 wickets, the most successful bowler. Kyle Mills, absolutely on the money, very economical, also picked up the wickets. 10 overs, 2 maidens, 232 for him. 1 for 67 for Andrew Ellis, pretty costly there. None for 42 for Nathan McCullum. 3 for 38 for James Franklin. And Kane Williamson bowled 2.2 overs, no maidens, none for 12. 1 over for 7, none for Grant Hilliard. As far as New Zealand were concerned, well, New Zealand made a perfect start to the one-day international series. In fact, the 258 target, they had to score at a clip of 5.21 runs per over, but finally they finished at 5.30 runs per over. 259 for 7 was what New Zealand made. But one thing that we would like to talk about here, as far as New Zealand innings were concerned, was Martin Guptill, who limped away but came back at the right time to join his captain, Brendon McCullum. Brendon McCullum was the hero there with an unbeaten 69 to his name of 61 balls with 6 fours and 3 sixes. Of what Brendon McCullum did today, he allowed Ross Taylor and Grant Elliott to go ahead of him, and he came at the end, which was pretty good because he finished off the match. Martin Guptill, even though he was limping, he came there and he had the gumption to actually hit a 6. He carved a 6 of the bowling of Anderson, which was pretty good to see. In fact, Martin Guptill, even though he was limping, he came in and joined. He had some pain, but he really struggled there. But for the team's cause, he came out and in fact came in and he also hit the winning runs. In fact, he hit a 6, he hit 2 boundaries, and he finished with an unbeaten 27 of as many balls with 4 fours and 1 6. So today, Brian Watling and Guptill were the ones who actually opened the batting for New Zealand. Kane Williamson showed tremendous class there by contributing in 74 runs of 99 deliveries, 6 fours, and he was run out. 22 coming in from Ross Taylor, 38 balls with 3 fours. Grant Elliott was involved in some useful partnerships. He contributed 22 of 24 balls with 2 fours. But Brendon McCullum was the man who actually took New Zealand to victory, contributing an unbeaten 69 of just 61 deliveries, 6 fours and 3 sixes. James Franklin contributed only 3. Nathan McCullum was out for 14 of 11 balls with 1 4 and 1 6. Andrew Ellis was out for 13 of 14 balls with 1 4. What one would like to say here is that as far as the England innings were concerned, England innings catapulted, I would say, because they were looking good at one particular stage where they were 184 for 3. From 84 for 3, one would expect that England score probably in excess of 300 runs, but that was not to be because of some good discipline New Zealand bowling, which restricted England to being 258 all out. And then New Zealand, on the other hand, they also had their moments, but they started losing wickets at regular intervals. But the key was that Brendon McCullum was there to place this wonderful innings to take them to victory. James Anderson became the highest wicket taker in one-day international for England, eclipsing the great Ian Botham's record and becoming taking 529 wickets. Anderson, 9 holes, 1 made and 1 for 36. Stephen Finn had 1 for 54, 1 for 56 for Broad, 2 for 52 for Wokes, 1 for 54. As New Zealand taking a head start in the One Day International Series in England, taking it 1-0. And the second One Day International is to come. The second One Day International is going to be played at Napier on 20th of February. That's it from me, your host Ram, for the cricket surf today. See you all tomorrow. Until then, it's goodbye. Thank you.